أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم I begin in the name of Allah, the most beneficent and most merciful. We all thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the tawfiq, for the inspiration Allah granted us to learn the etiquette of supplicating, to learn the means through which our du'as and our supplications are answered, because it definitely makes a huge difference how you communicate. It reflects what you are and what he is. And this du'a, du'a number 18, without further ado, I would try to quickly delve into my topic of discussion, is about the supplications when perils or trials were repelled or requests were quickly granted. So when the Imam was in a situation, in a state of trial, in a state of hardship, in a state of need, and when that need was fulfilled, then this is the dua that the Imam had made. Let us read the Arabic version first before we get further. Allahumma lakal hamdu ala husni khaza'ik wa bima sarafta anni min bala'ik fala taj'al hazzi min rahmatik ma ajjalta li min afiyatik fa akuna khad shaqitu bima ahbabtu wa sa'ida ghayri bima karahtu wa in yakun ma زللت فيه أو بت فيه من هذه العافية بين يدي بلاء لا ينقطع وذر لا يرتفع فخدم لي ما أخرت وأخر عني ما خدمت فغير كثير ما عاقبته الفناء وغير خليل ما عاقبته البقاء وَسَلِّ عَلَى مُحَمَّدٍ وَآلِ مُحَمَّدٍ محمد وَآلِ مُحَمَّدٍ So we find that the Imam first begins by praising اللهم لك الحمد على حسن قضائك O Allah, to you, to thee belongs praise for thy excellent accomplishment حسن قضائك Meaning that the outcome or the khaza, the destiny that you had kept for me, I praise you for that excellent destiny. Meaning that you have, you have saved me and I have come out of this trial which I was going through. وَبِمَا سَرَفْتَ عَنِّي مِنْ بَلَائِكَ And for thy trial which thou hast turned away from me. So I was in the state of bala, I was in the state of trial, I was in the state of calamity, and I thank you for turning it away from me, warding off from me. فَلَا تَجْعَلْ حَزِّي مِنْ رَحْمَتِكَ مَا أَجَّلْتَ لِي مِنْ آفِيَتِكَ But make not my share of thy mercy, the well-being which thou hast quickly granted to me, O Allah, make this not, lest I become wretched, through what I have loved, and someone else gain felicity through what I have disliked. But here the Imam is warning himself by saying, Allah, O Allah, do not make this success that has come about to me a source through which I would pursue things which I would like and fall from grace. While they were things that I disliked, other people took that and attained felicity, attained success. So Imam is being watchful of his soul, where Imam is saying that, let this success not make me arrogant. Let this success, let this coming out of this hardship that I was confronting, since I have come out of that hardship, should not make me proud that as a result of that, then I will dislike things that would be a source of success. Others will do those things and be successful. So Imam is conveying this message that, oh Allah, do not ignore me after that you have relieved me and saved me from this calamity. And then the Imam says, if this well-being in which I pass the day or night should precede a trial that does not cease and a burden that does not pass away, then set before me what thou had set behind and set behind me what thou had set before. Essentially, Imam is saying, if this success, if this warding away from the hardship, if what I have come out of, I came out of a calamity, if this success is, you know, a short-lived success, but there seems to be a trial in the future that is ought to come, which is going to be on a longer terms, then in that case, postpone what you have given me now for the next. That's what the Imam is saying. That I will bear this hardship, but don't let my future ruin. If this short-lived success is going to be followed by an eternal hardship, then I would rather have this rather than having that eternal hardship. And a burden that does not pass away, then set before me what thou had set behind, and set behind me what that thou had set before me. For that which ends, and then the Imam is justifying his statement, for that which ends in annihilation is not great, and that which ends in subsistence is not little. What the Imam is saying, the success, the current success, the success that I am confronting right now, if its akhibat, if its end is going to be annihilation, it's going to be fana, then this is not a great success, although it might be very, very big. And a baha, which is going to come after, although it might be small, that is, since it is everlasting, I would rather have that baha. So I have, then the Imam blesses Ahlul Bayt by his recitation of salawat. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala. I have looked upon some of the tafaseer in regards to bala. How this success that Imam is being watchful of, and what is Imam asking Allah of that eternal bliss, even if it is small, I would rather have that than having a success which looks in its outward sense big. For example, if a person, I always give this example to my friends that, you know, we are striving so hard to raise our children so that they have iman, they have the wealth of iman. What if our child becomes the richest man on earth, the greatest surgeon ever lived, or whatever you call, but if he does not possess iman, what is its worth? It is not worthy at all. Because this success is short-lived, but the eternal agony that we have to confront in the hereafter is going to be very, very long. And Allama Tehrani refers something similar, and he compares and he says that, what can't you see if somebody can have a golden glass or a golden utensil made of gold, very expensive, made of diamonds, but he uses that to throw up blood. Is that good? Or somebody having a glass made of earth and he can drink pure water in it? That gold is of no value if the person is throwing blood. It does not have any worth, because that gold is not going to hold him on. So this is what we have to see. So before we get in there, causes of trials. What are the causes of trials? Why does bala inflict us in the first place? So one of the things that the Mufassirin talk about is ignorance, asar-e-jahalat. Ignorance, it is the effect of ignorance. We are ignorant to such an extent that we suddenly wake up when we confront a calamity. So, a calamity, a trial, a tribulation, a bala is caused upon us or is inflicted upon us as a result of our ignorance. We are not paying attention. You know, suddenly we get ourselves checked up and we say, okay, now, you know, this was the warning sign. I better, you know, mend my ways. I better straighten my record and be on the path which is a path of a purposeful life. Another cause of bala is tughyan-e-shahwat, rebellion of lust and desires. Person becomes rebellious and starts pursuing his desires which are not legitimate desires. That is also is a cause of calamity, bala, trial that is inflicted upon him in his life. And when that comes in, it sets his mind straight and he realizes that, yes, I have not been acting up to the expectations of my Creator, and that becomes a source of guidance, in fact. Another cause of bala is pride and arrogance. Masti and ghurur. Sometimes people become so arrogant with what they have become or what they have made of themselves. They think that they are invisible. Nobody can touch them. Nobody can get closer to them. Even nations who thought like that, Allah had proven even in our lives that even a small force, if it stands up in the name of Allah, could shatter that invisibility. And here, so this pride and arrogance. Another cause of trial and tribulation is to enhance and train a person so he can attain higher stations, maqamat. For example, before I get to the example, you know, to attain kamal, if we want to attain kamal, if we want to attain perfection, we have to go through trials and tribulations. Now, if I want to compare that with matter, like material, then for example, the iron ore that you extract from the earth, it is very, very crude. What do they do? Who purify and who separate it, or who make the iron ore into iron? It goes through a very, very grueling process. First, they try to separate the earth from it, and then they heat it up, and then they boil it up, and then they liquefy so that iron ore is melted at thousands of degrees of temperature where it becomes like a liquid, and then the impurities are separated so it can purify. Or for that matter, you can see how gold is purified. The higher the criteria, the more tougher processes are applied to purify it. Or if you see how crude that is extracted from earth is converted into gasoline. There are different grades. When you go to a gas station, you find three different grades depending on the octane level. But all these gas that you see on the gas station is not the same gas that is used in a jet fuel, for example, or the fuel that is used for aircrafts. It is much more higher in purity and it is much more combustible. Okay, so, but it has to at the same time go through a lot more grueling process, and it becomes more and more expensive. That's how things become more expensive. So here also, if somebody is mu'min and if he is trying to attain a higher level of iman, then he has to go through trials and tribulations. And this is a logical explanation that human beings can perceive and feel is seen in our daily lives. If anything needs to get to a higher purity level, it has to go through those extractions where it becomes basit, meaning it becomes immutable. You cannot separate. You separate it to such an extent that there is nothing else left to separate but that element that you are trying to extract from it. So this is how Iman is also. Iman of everyone is not at the same level. And who else could know better than this than us? Because we know that the level of Iman that Salman had was not the same level that Abu Zar had or other companions of the Holy Prophet and other companions of our Aimma. That Iman is dynamic. Iman is fluid. It keeps moving. Either it goes up or it goes down. And trials and tribulations become a source of enhancing our Iman. And then tarfi'ud daraja, to enhance or raise our station, trials and tribulations is used. And also for repentance. Trials and tribulations is a source of cleansing our sins and seeking forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, if you look at different types of trials, amraz, you find, you know, diseases, mu'mineen, sometimes you find that, you know, I see a lot of young people, but there are some old people also who can understand this share of Iqbal. Iqbal in Shikwa says, Rahmatein hai teri aghyar ke kashanon par, barkh girti hai to bechare musalmanon par. So when you see that other people are in, success, other people have ample, plenty resources, and they are living a life with wealth and comfort and no hardships. And if a Muslim feels, why am I going through this hardship? What did I do to deserve what I am going through? What was my mistake? Why did I acquire this disease? Why did I acquire this calamity? Why is Allah just? These are the questions that keep coming in our minds. And we have to know, because we possess Iman, because we are at a higher station in our soul, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is testing us and trying us to see our resilience, how strong we are. Okay? If you want to look at the strength of materials, you will find that aluminum is much weaker compared to iron. Why? It doesn't have that strength. It can break much easier. Okay? And now, of course, the human beings were able to mix and match many metals to make a lot stronger material. One of the things that you see in the cars right now, they are giving good fuel efficiency because they were able to reduce the weight of the car by taking away the metal that was on the car by replacing it with other materials that can be used. So we find that trials and tribulations become a source of purifying our sins or purifying our past mistakes, purifying our arrogance if we had some time in our lives. If these trials are inflicted upon us to refine our character, it is a blessing, not a calamity. If it is refining our character, then Allah, it was the blessing of Allah, He had stopped us because of this calamity, because of this trial that I was inflicted with. If it turned me around to becoming a human being again, then this was not a calamity, but rather it was a blessing. One who inflicts these calamities is Allah Himself. And Imam here is saying that this safety, that this afiyah that you granted to me should not suffice or refrain me from the afiyah of the hereafter. Oh Allah, you have given me respite. You have given me an opportunity. Now, but this opportunity should not become a source of being an obstacle from the hereafter, which is everlasting. That is what the Imam is shooting for. And we as believers, mu'mineen, what we need to see, what are our long-term consequences of our actions. Please recite the salawat. Allah. And here the Imam says, O my Creator, I am pleased if the trial is in the future, cause it today. If there is hardship that I am going to see, cause it today. And afiyat and safety of today can cost me afiyat of tomorrow, then this safety of today, move it to the future. I don't want the safety right now. I want it in the future. Because happiness of today will finally culminate. It will come to an end. However many they might be. However big this happiness is, as a cause of how many children I have, how many family members I have, how much wealth I have, how much bank balance I have, how many properties I own, this is going to be short-lived. However long that might be, it is short-lived compared to that afia that is going to come after it. If you are going to test me with this, I would rather be tested with this. But I want to ensure that my afia, although it might be small, although I might not be in the haram of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but if I can attain Jannah, I have truly accomplished the task for which I was created. That's why Amirul Mu'mineen says that the price for which a mu'min can sell himself, you know, everybody has a price, as they say, you know, it's up to us at what price we want to sell ourselves. And Imam says the minimum price for which a mu'min should sell himself should be Jannah. Nothing less than Jannah. If you can sell yourself, then the price should be Jannah. If you sell lower than that, then you have sold yourself cheap. And here we find that the Imam is asking for that eternal bliss, even though it might be small, because that is going to be everlasting. People are known, people show their character, people manifest themselves during the test of trial and tribulation. On a normal course of life, you might find people very courteous, very humble, very loving, very caring, but you should see them at the time of a trial. When they are going through hardship, are they withholding it? Do they have that sort of resilience not to complain? A little bit of economy goes bad. The discussions we have even in mosque during our dinners, what are we doing? How are things? Kya karein, huzoor, bataein, paycheck se paycheck pe zindagi guzar rahi hai. You know, we are living paycheck by paycheck. Yes, there are statistical data that I have seen years ago. 60% of US population is away from homelessness and poverty by two paychecks. If they don't get two paychecks, they will be homeless and they will fall into poverty. This is what is happening here right now. So yes, that is there. But ulama, like I remember marhum Ayatullah Mujtaba Musavi Lari, who passed away recently, in one of his books he mentions, when you say something like this, you are actually complaining about Allah to his creation. When Allah was your provider, he had granted you from sources and means that you had never thought of. You never came out and said, I got a bonus. You will never hear anybody saying, you know, my performance appraisal was good this year and I got a bonus. Nobody says that. But when the economy goes bad, or if the stock price of the stock that they own or the company they work goes down, suddenly they start complaining about God. So people are known by their character. They are tested by their character. And that character is manifested. It comes out in a time of a trial and a tribulation. True character is reflected in the state of a trial. And now if we look at the philosophy of trial and tribulations, and we ask Amirul Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib, the Imam says, وَأَنْ كَانَ سُبْحَانَهُ أَعْلَمَ بِهِمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ وَلَكِنْ لِتَزْحَرَ الْأَفْعَالُ أَلَّتِي بِهَا يُسْتَحَقُّ الثَّوَابُ وَالْإِخَابُ. Imam Ali says, Allah, although Allah knows, Allah is more aware of us, people, of them, than they themselves. We are not aware of ourselves. Allah is aware of us more than we are aware of ourselves. Then Imam says, trials exposes him to his action, the actions of the person, through which this person becomes worthy of either reward or retribution or chastisement. So Allah puts us through the trial so that He can reward us. It's not about the knowledge of Allah. Allah is lot more aware, He is more aware of us than we ourselves are aware of. These trials become a source of our actions. It reflect our character. So if our character while we are in comfort is such that we are very pious and we are God fearing, the moment we see fear around us, the moment we see threats around us, if we are shaken, then definitely that would be a cause of a loss in the hereafter. Then the mufassir of this dua, he mentions people under severe trials and tribulations from Allah would be divided into two categories. Those who overcome the trials and succeed, and those who fail and fall from the grace. So there are only two options. When the trial comes in, either you succeed in the trial and then get to the higher level, or if you fall, then that fall is going to be a great fall. And some of the examples are like fear. Fear causes some of us to refrain from many, many things. Just the fear. There was nothing happening, only some threat, and you will find people suddenly they turn 180 degrees. They free themselves of their responsibility. When they fear for a very minute loss, they say, okay, I'm not responsible. Do whatever you want. They will not take a stand. They will not take a position. They will flee in the battlefield. They will go in the battlefield hoping that Baitul Mal is going to be ours and we are going to win. But when they see the blood in the battlefield, they flee from the battlefield out of fear. They were not inflicted with wounds. Or they will end up adopting deceit and dishonesty because of the fear. People being sold. All you have to do right now, a lot of things that I hear from people, that if the government wants you to work for them, all they have to do is just threaten you, and then next thing you are become the most obedient servant, making sure that you abide by everything they want and making sure that you provide everything they want. Okay? Only out of fear. Nothing has yet happened. Why is this happening? Because of the fear of loss that we perceive or conceive, that if something happens, what would happen to my livelihood? What would happen to this and what would happen to that? And they will just start imagining. As a result of that, they would not be able to take a stand even for a small thing. And this would ruin them. Bring excuses of the loss that they could receive and back off. During the dinner, I was telling a brother that how Ibn Ziyad, when Hazrat Muslim was in Kufa, and all the Kufans had paid allegiance to Hazrat Muslim, at least 18,000 of them, and Ibn Ziyad arrives into Kufa, and he locks himself up in the palace because he had only 30 or 32 guards protecting him. The whole city had turned against Ibn Ziyad. And Muslim had even surrounded the palace of Ibn Ziyad. But with only 32 people, Ibn Ziyad was able to overcome all these people by mere threats. All he did was called all the heads of the tribes and he threatened them that the message has reached Sham and Yazid is sending a huge army, and when that army arrives, I am telling you now, even if one person from your tribe deceives me or is not loyal to me, I will make sure that not only that person, but your whole tribe is wiped out. He only threatened. And when those threats were not making effect, Ibn Ziyad called upon women. And he spoke to the women. And he said, your husbands have lost their mind. They do not understand the severity of the crime that they are going to commit by supporting Muslim ibn Akhil. The army from Sham is coming, and when it comes, your sons will be killed in your laps. They cave in, only merely out of fear. Only by fear, Ibn Ziyad was able to completely control the people of Kufa. He did not have to strike a sword. And we know that later on he killed a Muslim, and Muslim ibn Awsajah, Hani ibn Urwa, and Muslim ibn Akhil. So we find that this fear, my dear brothers and sisters, if we do tawakkul, if we do rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this fear, Mufassirin say, is a disease that could corrupt our souls. Here the verse in the tafsir of this dua refers to a verse of Surah Maida, verse 52, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling people like this: yet you see those in whose heart is a sickness rushing to them, saying, we fear lest a turn of fortune should visit us. Maybe Allah will bring about a victory or a command from Him, and then they will be regretful for what they kept secret in their hearts. So they will feel Allah's help will come. In the meantime, let us just, we should not do anything. We should just be passive. We should comply with everything. We should be in such a state that the state would be happy, or whoever wants us to be in whatever direction, we have to comply by that. Allah would do, And we hear all along, my dear brothers and sisters, that Allah's help would come, Imam Zamana would come, he will bring his own force. Why do we have to worry? In the meantime, we have to be smart. Mu'min should be smart. And being smart means being deceptive. Being smart means being dishonest. Being smart means, doing khiyanat. No, of course not. Being smart means setting your priorities right. What is ahem and what is muhim? If you know what your priorities are, once you hold on to it, then you are steadfast on that priority. How do we attain the path of success in the state of trial? This is my last point, in which ulama say patience and steadfastness. When you are confronted with trial, tribulations, hardships, what you should be? You should be patient. You should acquire patience and bear the hardships with patience. The other thing that you should do to overcome the trials and tribulations is self-realization of perishable nature of this world. You should think on those lines. And you should, in fact, ulama say that you should utter the kalame istirja, which is inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un. We see Imam Hussein on the day of Ashura, he was reciting Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un. In the state of trial, in the state of calamity. Seeking help from our faith and awaiting Allah's grace. Because our iman tells us that we are in the presence of our Creator, in the presence of our Lord, and He is watching us. It is not like He is not seeing us. Oh Allah, You are watching. I am doing my best to be patient. You do what you can do, because nothing can stop you from doing what you can do. Having that sense of self-realization, and when we speak to our Creator, do you think Allah is going to let us go through this without helping us out? No, it is not going to be like that. Reflecting that our hardships are not hidden from Allah. They are not hidden from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, reflecting upon that. Oh Allah, You are witness to this. Yesterday also I was mentioning this. You have seen Imam Hussein, how Imam Hussein, when Hazrat Ali Akbar was leaving, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Imam Hussein calls Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and say, oh Allah, You are witness. You are witnessing what I am going through when I am sending my son Ali Akbar. So my dear brothers and sisters, the discussion could go further, but keeping you know, the time or taking the time into account, I would rather stop here, inshallah, and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we take these concepts that our a'imma have taught us and, you know, descend it onto our hearts and absorb it with our hearts, so that when a trial, when a calamity inflicts us, we actually manifest these values and act upon it as the Imam had mentioned here. Please cite aloud salawat. Okay, wasn't I the one who told that in our Sunday school? I thought, yeah. Yeah, I think I told that. Yes, it's a true hadith. Of course it's a true hadith. And I have seen that hadith first when I was studying fiqh in a very renowned book called Luma. The question is that if women prays in their house, they would get more sawab and compared to men. How is that so? So what I have seen is there is jihad. There is, you know, going and serving your life for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the battlefield, which is assigned to men. Of course, jihad is not there for women. So how do women attain a higher station? So in that context, there is a hadith in which the Prophet of Allah had said that if a woman makes a niyyah, before I even say that, let me tell you what is the sawab, okay? If you are praying salat in a masjid, in a jama'ah over here, right? In a masjid nearby your home, okay? So there is, say, tenfold sawab. I'm just putting a number, it's not the right one. Tenfold sawab. So if you do a salat in a jama masjid, meaning the central mosque of your city, then the sawab goes a little higher. Then you go from there all the way to Mecca, the sawab goes like exponentially high if you are in the precincts of around Kaaba. Then if you actually get into the Kaaba, the sawab keeps going up in many, many folds. And if you are praying in the shrines of Ahlul Bayt, the sawab is very, very high. But the narration says that the sawab that a woman would attain is based on the niyyah that she makes. If a woman right here makes the niyyah that I am making my salat of Maghrib in Haram of Imam Hussein, she will get the sawab of Haram of Imam Hussein. If a woman makes a niyyah that I am making a niyyah that I am praying this salat in the house of Allah, in Kaaba, she will get the sawab as if she was physically there and praying. And that sawab is not there for men. It's only for women.
Who has quoted this hadith?
It's in a book. Well, I can pull it up, but it's in Luma. Luma is a very, very powerful book of fiqh in which I have seen this. That a sawab for a woman is where she prays with the niyyah that she makes. Yeah. Yeah.
So that means we should always make the niyyah that we are.
Yes, of course. Of course.
Men
can make it, but the sawab is for women.
Any more questions from sister side?
You.
Anybody from the other side? Go ahead, Mati.
So, if you see somebody doing what's wrong, and you know that they're doing 100% without any doubt they're doing wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And I've heard stories like about their mom, they did, it wasn't the person to show that they're wrong. But now in communities, like, people are ignorant now, so they're not, they're going to think that we're doing it wrong instead. How do we, like, deal with this situation?
Where Amr bil Ma'ruf and Nahi anil Munkar, that is part of Ru'edin, it is also wajib. But you have to see the conditions of doing Amr bil Ma'ruf. Amr bil Ma'ruf becomes wajib when actually it is something that is going to happen in the future. You cannot have Amr bil Ma'ruf for something that has passed and it's not going to come back again. You do for something that is going to happen in the future. And then you see whether that person is receptive to your word or not. Will he be able to take this? Will he be able to sort of digest it if you say, or he's going to become very offended? Okay. If he's going to be offended, then rather than saying it to him, you try to seek channels and ways trying to go to him. And then what time you're using it, you know, what time you're doing it. Is it going to become a source of, dishonoring him in any ways? If that is the case, then you should avoid that time and try to take an opportunity when you are alone with him, and you should say, brother, I have been to Sunday school and I have been, you know, I have learned this and this is what I think is, and if you have any doubt, I could go off, or we could go off and look into the Risala of Maraji and find out how it is. But if you can, definitely you should say. But you should say it in such a way that that person's stature, his, you know, position is not ridiculed in front of other people. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين اياك نعبد واياك نستعين صلاة انعمت علينا وعلى المسلمين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم اللهم صل على اللهم صل اللهم صل بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم اللهم كن لوليك الحجة ابن الحسن صلواتك عليه وعلى آبائه في هذه الساعة وفي كل ساعة وليا وحافظا وقائدا وناصرا ودليلا وعينا حتى تسكنه أرضك طوعا وتمتعه فيها طويلا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد